Tonight we are in the book of Acts. The book of Acts, Acts chapter number 27. So Acts chapter 27, we will read responsively together. We will begin reading in verse 5. I will read the odd verses, and let's read the even verses together, please. We'll read from 5 down to verse 20. So Acts chapter 27, verses 5 through 20, and the Bible says in Acts chapter 27, verse number 5, "And when we had sailed over the sea of Cilicia and Pamphylia, we came to Myra, a city of Lycia. And there the centurion found a ship of Alexandria sailing into Italy, and he put us therein. And when we had sailed slowly many days, and scarce was come over against Cnidus, the wind not suffering us, we sailed under Crete over against Salmone. And hardly passing it, we came unto a place which is called the Fair Havens, nigh whereunto was the city of Lycia. Now when much time was spent, and when sailing was now dangerous, because the fast was now already past, Paul admonished them, and said unto them, Sirs, I perceive that this voyage will be with hurt and much damage, not only of the lading of the ship, but also of our lives. Nevertheless, the centurion believed the master of, and the owner of the ship more than those things which were spoken by Paul. And because the haven was not commodious to winter in, the more part advised to depart thence also, if by any means they might attain unto Phinis, and there to winter, which is an haven of Crete, and lieth toward the southwest and northwest." Verse 13, "And when the south wind blew softly, supposing that they had obtained their purpose, loosing thence, they sailed close by Crete. But not long after, there arose against it a tempestuous wind called Euroclydon. And when the ship was caught and could not bear up into the wind, we let her drive. And running under a certain island, which is called Clauda, we had much work to come by the boat, which when they had taken up, they used helps, undergirding the ship, and fearing lest they should fall into the quicksand, strake sail, and so were driven. And we, being exceeding tossed with a tempest, the next day they lighted the ship. The third day we cast out with our own hands the tackling of the ship. And when neither sun nor stars in many days appeared, and no small tempest lay on us, all hope that we should be saved was then taken away." Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, again, thank you so much. We can be in your house tonight. Thank you, Lord, for those that come faithfully. Lord, we also thank you for those that this morning came back. God, we thank you for this place. It's a lighthouse to people that may come back. And again, God, thank you so much for your word. Please speak to us through it even tonight. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Measured out my days, life carried me along. In my soul I yearned to follow God, but knew I'd never be so strong. I looked hard at this world to learn how heaven could be gained. Just where will I begin, where human effort is all in vain? Were it not for grace, I can tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up So here is all my praise, expressed with all my heart, offered to a friend who took my place and ran the course I could not even start. And when he saw in full just how much his love would cost, he still went the final mile between me and heaven, so I will not be lost. And were it not for grace, I can tell you where I'd be, wandering down some pointless road to nowhere, with my salvation up to me. I know how that would go.
Thank you, Karina. You'll be the first one asleep. Thank you. Okay, good. He's excited because he's getting out of town. This is a very interesting passage of scripture. I've read this probably 100 times, and I've always been fascinated by this story. One of the things, and it's not what we're going to speak on tonight. I love it how Paul starts the chapter as a prisoner, and by the end of the chapter, he's calling the shots. He's encouraging people. He's telling them what to do, and he's helping them. But that's not what I want to look at tonight. I want us to understand and see something about storms. Of course, when I mean storm, I mean it's a problem that comes our way that we need to deal with. It could be trials that God allows in our life to strengthen our faith, and to mature us. In this story, there was a great storm. It pictures all of that. Storms reveal a lot about us and our Christian life. We know the story in Luke when Jesus talks about the two men that build their houses on the foundation, and one builds it on sand, and a storm comes, and their house is destroyed. The other built their house on a rock, and their house stands strong in the storm. But Jesus said, this illustrates someone who listens to what God says, and they do what God says. Whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doeth them, I will show you to whom he is like. And so our obedience level shows what we're building our lives on. And our lives must be built on a very strong foundation, or else when problems come in life, we will not make it through there. We can have issues, and in worst case scenario, Christian lives can be destroyed. But I do want us to understand that these storms or problems in our life come from one of two places. I want you to get this, and then we'll move into the message tonight. They either are allowed of God to help to mature and strengthen us. James chapter 1, verses 2 to 4 says, "My brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations." The word temptations there means trials. "Knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience." In other words, when God allows these storms in our life, it helps us to develop a patience in our life. And in verse 4, he says, "But let patience have her perfect work," or maturing work, "that you may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing." God says sometimes I allow situations in your life so that you can learn from them, and it matures you as an individual, it matures you as a Christian, and in the faith. But there's another place that storms come from. These storms are self-inflicted. Now, those type of storms are not the same as the one that God allows. God allows storms, and he may not, and sometimes we think, why did God do this in my life? Sometimes God doesn't do it, Brother Pichardo. Sometimes God allows it, but even in his allowing it, God will use it if we will let him to work in our lives. But there are other storms that come that is hard for God to work, because these storms come because of our disobedience, because we do some things that cause these storms to come, and they are very difficult to deal with. Some storms are unavoidable, the ones that God allows, so we must be prepared for them, but most storms are avoidable. I don't mind going through a storm if God has that for me, and God has specifically dictated that comes so that he can help me to become the Christian that he wants me to be. I'm fine. I don't like it, neither do you, but I'm okay with it. But I am not okay with storms that would come into my life that were avoidable simply because I didn't decide right and I did not act right. Those are the ones that bother me. Now let's get to the text this evening. Paul had decided that God wanted him in Rome to preach the gospel, and actually that was God's will. That's what God wanted to do. The way he got there is he had been arrested for preaching the gospel and they were mistreating him, and he appealed to Caesar, which was the right of any Roman citizen. And Paul was a Roman citizen. We won't go into how he got it. Paul was a freeborn Roman citizen. And so as they were mistreating him, he said, fine, I'll appeal to Caesar. And they're like, fine, you'll go. Well, that involved taking a trip and getting him to Rome. When we come to this part, he is on the final leg of that journey, and they are taking him to Rome. Little did he know when he made that decision and he understood what God was going to do, the twists and turns that it would take to get him there. As we looked in our story, the centurion, the one that was overseeing that particular group that was going to be taken to see Caesar, some of them were not like Paul, some of them were criminals, and they were going to get what was coming to them. So he takes Paul and he finds a ship that's taking them to Caesarea and then to Sidon. As they go to Sidon, Paul is permitted to speak to some of his friends. From there, they go to Myra. But the trip is a little more difficult because of the winds. When they are there, the centurion finds a large grain ship to continue their voyage. It's a large ship because we are told that there are 276 passengers on that later on in the chapter when the worst part of the storm hits. As they continue, the weather gets a little bad, and they end up in a place called the Fair Havens, which we read. Now, while they're at Fair Havens, it is getting towards, if you follow the timeline, they are probably in the September, October time frame there, and so winter is coming, and it's very, in those days particularly, you didn't want to be traveling during their winters. And so as they're at Fair Havens, and they know the time is coming when they're going to have to winter. In other words, they're going to have to just hunker down where they're at and stay there for several months until the storm's clear and they can get free sailing to continue on to end up in Rome. And so as they're at Fair Haven, they have to make a decision on if they're going to stay there or move on. They decide that they want to take the trip to Phoenix, which is really another word for Phoenix. And it's about a 40-mile trip. They finally decide that's what they're going to do. Now, Paul, the prisoner, Paul was pretty bold. I like him. Here's Paul, a prisoner on the ship, that steps up and says, you know what? This is not a good idea. Paul had, I don't know if God told him particularly, and later on God did talk to him. I don't know if Paul's just looking at the wind saying, that's a really bad idea. Okay, better to just stay here. Well, they decide, of course, not to listen to Paul. And they take off, and we read part of the story. We didn't read the whole chapter. And because of that decision to go, which was a disastrous decision, the ship takes off. They don't get to where they're going to. They have to let it ride. It runs ashore, and the ship is destroyed. They barely escape with their life. They're cast on an island. They're left on that island for 3 months until another ship comes by. Paul gets bitten by the whole nine yards. Just problem after problem after problem. Well, what was the problem? The problem was they made a bad decision in the first place. That was not a storm that they needed to be in. all the drama that happens throughout that entire chapter, all of that could have been avoided if they had just made the right decision. This story is a classic illustration of how not to determine the will of God. In other words, how not to determine what does God want in my life? What am I supposed to do when I'm making this decision? If you look at this chapter, and I've read it so many times, and I was recently reading it, it just hit me. Like, they made a really bad decision. As I read through it, I just kind of saw some thoughts in there. It's like, that's why they ended up in the storm. This chapter shows us not how to make life-altering decisions. Because if we make decisions the wrong way, we're going to end up in the wrong place. We will head right into a storm that we never needed to be in the first place. So tonight, I want us to see six bad decisions that will show you if you're heading into a storm. Not a storm that God has directed. A storm that you have created by not finding God's will. Or I could lead into because I don't find God's will. What were the six bad decisions? Let me give them to you briefly. You say six, it's like, man, we're going to be here forever. I know, I can see the clock. It's right there. We won't be long tonight. Number one, here's the first bad decision. When you ignore spiritual insight. That's a biggie. Look at verse 10. Have your Bibles open in chapter 27. We're gonna look at some of the verses. Verse 10. And said unto them, Paul, I perceive that this voyage will be with hurt and much damage, not of the landing of the ship, but also of our lives. Now, I understand Paul was no sea captain. Paul was no mariner. Paul didn't know anything. He wasn't a weatherman. By the way, I wonder if the weathermen are the weathermen. I'm pretty convinced they just open the window and say, hey, today's forecast, it is sunny for the next 15 minutes. They have no clue. No clue. So Paul wasn't a mariner. Paul wasn't a weatherman. But Paul did know one thing. Paul knew God. And God gave Paul insight. Paul was to testify in his, by the way, Paul knew he was going to testify in Rome. God had already let him know he's going to be there. So to me, if I know that was God's will for Paul to be there, I'm going to follow his advice. But of course, these men, particularly not being Christians, did not follow his advice. Let me say this, and listen up this evening. That's where all of our bad decisions start. When we forsake spiritual insight and we make decisions based on anything else other than that. Now, we don't do the things that we need to find the spiritual insight. We ought to always be praying to find out what God wants. Now, when I say that, I need to backtrack for a second about praying to find what God wants. This is a bit of a two-edged sword. See, so often we pray because we're trying to force our will on God. Or we're trying to get God to put his stamp of approval on what we've already decided we're going to do. And so often we pray half-heartedly, and really we just kind of throw it out there, and we really don't have a heart to find out what God wants. Now, I will say this. If something is clearly stated in Scripture, we don't need to pray about that. We just follow it. But so often we pray and we have our own will. Our prayers are nothing more than trying to get God to agree with what we want. Let me say this. When we pray and we're asking for God to lead us in our life, we shouldn't have an agenda. We shouldn't already decided what we want. Okay? We shouldn't, you know, now God, this is what I want, Lord, and I pray that you would let me to do it. No, we ought to always pray, Lord, what do you want for my life? Father, I feel like maybe this is it, but Lord, if this isn't it for you, let me know. I want to know your will. I've heard so many make mistakes, and yet before the decision, they'll say, I've prayed about it, and here we go. And I have peace. You know, peace doesn't mean anything. Peace just means there's no problems. Peace could just mean because you're not willing to listen to God, he's not speaking to you. Okay? Peace has nothing to do with it. Because if we pray and something is what God wants us to do, God will direct us. First and second, we ought to also be searching to see what God says. If I'm making a big decision in my life, you need to spend extra time in His Word. You know, so often we want to speak to God in these situations, but we don't want Him to speak to us. Okay? Like they say, what do they say? God gave us two ears and one mouth. We ought to listen twice as much as we talk. But when it comes to God, how often is it we want to talk more than we want to listen? And by the way, if we're not committed to following what God would give us, tell us to do in the first place, a lot of times God really will not give us any answers. Or we ask ourselves when we're deciding to do something, am I violating any principles of Scripture? It is best when making a decision to let God speak to you more than you're speaking to Him. But many people don't want to ask God because they don't want to be, in a sense, rebuked in what they want to do. And then we ought to find counseling to confirm what God wants. Talk to some spiritual people. If I'm a young person, I'm going to talk to my parents. Okay? Wouldn't hurt to talk to the pastor every now and then. You may be forgetting something. But counseling, again, is not trying to get a stamp of approval on what you've already decided. I'll be honest with you, and I'm not going to say this with a mean spirit, but people come sometimes, and it's like, I've decided to do this. And they already tell me what they decided. And it's like, what do you think? What do you think I think? I'm not going to tell you. Because you've already decided, and I'm not going to be the bad guy. Now, I'll give you a couple thoughts maybe to think about, but am I going to tell you to go again? You're not giving me that right. I'll kind of be nice and say, you know, here's a couple things before you make a decision you ought to decide, but you've already decided in your heart. And I'm not going to put my stamp of approval on it. That's your decision. That's fine. And by the way, I'm not God. I'm not telling you what to do. Okay? But I do want to help you to make sure you're making the right decision. Because so often we make wrong decisions and we get messed up. And be careful why you're making the right decision, by the way. Some just go to a counselor and say, you know, yeah, by the way, some people come and talk to you so they can go say, no, I talked to Pastor. Yeah. That's fine. Did you ask him what he thought before you already decided? I'm not sure. I remember people used to come to me like, they're doing something with, oh, you really? Yeah. Yeah, I talked to Pastor about it. That's Pastor Esposito back in the day. I go to Pastor, hey, so-and-so told me what they're doing. They said they talked to you about it and they said you're good with it. Like, I didn't say that. Okay. It's like, all right. It's better not to come talk if you've already decided. But me, if I make it a decision and it's a big decision, I want to see what other people think. Because all of us are, we all have blinders because that's how we are in our flesh, right? And we don't see things that maybe someone outside of ourselves might see. And it's nice for them to say, by the way, the one thing I really appreciate about Pastor Esposito, he would come in staff meeting, or he'd maybe hit the pastoral staff and said, hey, I'm thinking of doing this. What do you guys think? And he didn't want a yes man. Like, oh, Pastor, you said it's great. Let's do it. You know, if we would, and there were several times, particularly as a church, one of us would point out, like, hey, have you thought about this? You know, I hadn't thought about that yet. This was just the thought I'm doing. He goes, that's a good thought. And he'd take the thought. Okay? So we just want to force things. So we ignore spiritual insight. When you ignore spiritual insight, when you don't really want to find out what God wants, you've already decided what you want. These men already did that. Secondly, we make bad decisions when we receive biased info. We receive biased information. Look at verse 11. So Paul says, listen, we shouldn't go. I'm just getting the vibe here that things aren't going to go well. And here's what they say. Nevertheless, the centurion believe the master and the owner of the ship more than those things which Paul said. Now, the centurion is by no means a mariner also. He probably knew less about storms and things than even Paul knew. And who's he listening to? He's listening to the owner of the ship. Why? You think the owner didn't have an agenda? The owner wants to push that thing down the road, okay? That people are renting that thing. Keep it going. Let's just keep it going. Centurion says, that's what I want to do too. And this guy, after all, the owner said it's okay to go. Biased information. His counsel was based on bias. A lot of decisions are based on bias. You know, sometimes the bias in our decisions is ourselves, right? We already have a dog in the race. You know, we've already decided what we want, so therefore we're biased towards that right way. And whenever you're biased already coming into any decision, you're going to make the bad decision. I remember there was a guy I knew well when I was in Bible college. And he was a good guy. And he had met this girl at Bible college, and they were dating. And he got engaged to her. About 6 months before their wedding, his dad, who was a good man, he had been on board with it. He just came to his son and said, "Son, the more I've been thinking and praying about this, I don't think this is the right decision." I mean, I'm talking about 6 months before the wedding. Dad didn't hate the girl. He was okay. He's just like, I just don't think this is the right decision. I think you ought to let it go for right now. Now, usually at that point, can I tell you what happens? No kid's going to bail out. And this guy, without any reservation, said, "Dad, if you feel that's what I should do right now, that's what I'm going to do." And it turned out to be the right decision for him. See, but we get biased. I've already decided what I've wanted. I already decided what is right. And everything else that comes around us, instead of listening to it, we're trying to find ways to refute it. Sometimes the bias of the person promoting the decision. Never make a decision when you're being pressured by somebody to make a decision, by the way. Whenever you feel pressure to make a decision, that's always time to say, "Let me just step back for a while." Why do people spend so much for new cars? Do you know there's a reason cars don't have a firm sales price? Because the salesman is trying to think, how much can I get from you? I knew somebody that used to be in our church years ago, and before he was saved, he was a car lot. He ran a car lot. And he used to say, I forget the phrase he used, but he said there was some people coming in. It's like, "All right, we're going to get rich off this one." Because they pressured him. Whenever I buy, I'm like, "I'm not going in your box. I'm not talking to you. We'll deal later." They just try to pressure you. And some people are pressuring you into decision, whether it's a peer or whatever. And listen, whenever you feel the pressure, someone's being biased, and it's time for you to bail out on that. That's why I don't like Ashley's furniture. We were looking for some furniture, and I went to a couple of furniture stores, they didn't pay me to say this, but I'd be there. They're like, the salesman followed us around. We went into one place, Living Space. They're like, "Hey, we're not on commission. Go do what you want. Let us know if you have questions." We went to Ashley Furniture. The guy said, "Hey, let me help you." I said, "We don't need our help. We're just looking." And he was literally, I think Allison was with, he was following us. It's almost like I turned around and he's like, "Okay." I'm like, "I don't see you." Man, and they pressure you to buy it. I don't want pressure. Don't receive biased info. Bad decision number 3. When you dislike your present situation. Now look at verse 12. And because the haven, remember they were at the fair havens before they took off, trying to get to Phoenix. And because the haven was not commodious to winter in. Now, geography tells us that's true. The fair havens was not a well blocked off to protect from the wind. Probably was a little bit colder there. That was not the place they wanted to hang out during the winter. It would be better to go to Phoenix, which was more of an enclosed little harbor there, and they could get in there, and it would block the winds. It would just be a better place to be during the wintertime. So one of the reasons they wanted to push down there, they didn't want to be at this place. This place, in their mind, was not as good as that place. But the fact was that it did not matter which place was best to winter in. The real question was, which place was the safest to be when you're in on that ship? I bet you when they were in that ship in that storm, a lot of them were thinking back to like, you know what? There's a reason Paul was running it when they got to the end. A lot of them were probably thinking, that prisoner was right. We shouldn't have taken off. We should have listened. But they let the fact that they were not comfortable with their present situation push them to do something that was, in essence, risky. We call that being discontent. Sometimes we don't like the pressure that's going on around us. We don't like what's happening to us at that present time. And we're making decisions not based on what's best because we just want to get out of here. Hey, could it be that God's maybe using that to make you what he wants you to be? Could it be that we're taking ourselves out of the place that God wants us to be, and it doesn't matter whether we like it, because God knows what's best for us, and the place we thought for best was best for us wasn't best for them? Don't be discontent. Sometimes we move also because we're not doing well where we are at. I've had people say, you know, I'm just spiritually, I'm not doing well. I'm going to go somewhere else because if I go there, I'll magically change. You're not going to magically change. Fact of the matter is, you really want the truth? I'll be a little unnice for a minute. Usually you step down. By the way, some of you didn't make decisions because you want less commitment. And I see it in your actions and some of the other things, and if you want to know, come ask me about it. But that's what happens. We're just discontent, and we think, man, I instead of just doing what we're supposed to do where we're at, we think we have to go somewhere else to get that. No, because here's what happens when you think that. Think for a minute. If I get up and say, I'm just not doing here, Brother Bachardo, as a Christian, I'm struggling and there's some issues, you know, I'm going to go, you know, 500 miles away and that's going to help me. Do you know what's waiting for me 500 miles away when I get there? Me. I'm taking me with me. And I'm the source of the problem. And if I can't get it together where I'm at, how am I going to get it together 1,000 miles away? Okay? No. Just work on where you're at. But we don't like our present situation and we're trying to avoid it. And we make a decision not based on what's best. We make a decision based on discontent with what's going on in our life right now. By the way, problems happen everywhere you go. You have a different problem. Number four. The fourth bad decision. When you believe conventional wisdom. Back to verse 12. And because the haven was not commodious to winter, it says, the more part advised to depart thence also. Not only was now the centurion was being swayed by the owner of the ship, the master and the owner, now the rest of the people get on board and say, hey, yeah, that sounds like the right thing to do. I know this, when you follow the crowd, you're headed the wrong direction. The majority of people are usually wrong, especially in a spiritual sense. But we don't want to buck the system. We don't want to go against our peers. Be careful. So many people, especially you young people, you make decisions based on what your friends say. You know, by the way, I love young people. I do. I love young people, but I'll say this. When it comes to life skills, now I'm not saying we have some of the best young people in the world, but when it comes to life skills and seniority in life, you ain't got any. Because you're not lived long enough. That's all. You know, your 17-year-old friend tells you, man, this is going to be really, you know, we got this going. It's going to be great. Oh, okay, that's what I'm going to do. Listen, seriously? He doesn't even know how to shave yet. Okay, he's done nothing with his life. He doesn't even have a job. Okay, he never paid a bill in his life. Why don't we look to people that are a little more skilled in life than we are? But we go to our friend, Rehoboam. You know, hey, what do we do? His friend's like, oh, you're the king now. That's going to be really cool, man. You're in charge, you know, and you can be mean, and you can, like, run everything and stuff. And it's like, yeah. And Rehoboam gets up there like, I'm going to make my dad look like a liberal. And they're like, later. 10 of the tribes said, we're gone. You can be like that, but we're not going to be a part of it. Quit following your friends. Now, by the way, you ought to encourage each other. I'm not saying that. Encourage people to, you know, if your friend says, you know, if your 17-year-old friend says, man, we ought to read our Bible more. Pastor Meyers said, now I'm not supposed to listen to you. Okay, that's not what I'm talking about. You know, but when they're trying to sell you on something, it's not only 17 or 18, it's like 20 to 25, okay, really. But you know what happens? I mentioned this earlier, a couple weeks ago. We allow those who are in our own peer group or a couple years older, we allow what they say to put a stamp of approval on what we want to do instead of somebody else that maybe has been down the road a little bit longer. You know, I'm not a big Bobby Knight fan. He had a lot of issues as a basketball coach. But I remember what he said one time. He told a bunch of reporters, he goes, listen, they were giving him a hard time about something. He said, listen, I have forgot more about basketball than you'll ever know. That's just experience speaking. So let's not just follow the crowd. You know, if we follow the crowd, we wouldn't do anything spiritual, right? Because conventional wisdom tells us a lot of things that are wrong. You know, conventional wisdom says giving your money is a waste because you can live better off of all of it than part of it. Conventional wisdom says doing what I want makes me happy. Listen, if what you want to do isn't right, it's not going to make you happy. It's going to make you miserable. Doing what God wants makes you happy. Conventional wisdom says joy is found in all of the things of this world. Whereas the Bible tells us joy is found in our relationship with God. So let's not just follow conventional wisdom. But we do that when we forget the first one, is where we don't follow spiritual insight. The fifth bad decision they make. Well, we make the decision because we're seeking a better position. And he says, if by any means they might attain to Phoenix, and there to winter, which is a haven of Crete, and lieth towards the south. What he's saying is, that's just a better place. And I want something better than what I have right now. We make decisions based on what we feel will get us a better position in life. Some of you young folks are afraid to come to God and say, God, if you would want me to serve you in a serious way and maybe a more of a long-term manner, I would do it. Some of you are afraid to do that because you think that would put you in a lower position in life. Actually, serving God is better. Now, some of you, if you're not serving God full-time, it doesn't make you sing. I'm not saying that. Don't get me wrong. But if that's what God wants for you and you choose something else, even if you make a lot of money at it, you chose something less. Well, I want this, and that just seems like a better position in life, and that just seems like a better place to be. And by the way, if that's what God has for you, that's fine. But if you never considered it before, you know, I heard someone say one time in relation to that, not willing to give our lives to God if God wants it. He said, success is something we usually settle for when we don't want to follow God's will. Look, everybody wants to be Russell Anderson. He's a millionaire, and he's a Christian, and he gives money away to ministries, and it's like, I want to be Russell Anderson. I give my money away. Of course, you don't give anything of your $10 away, okay? So, but, yeah, we need less Russell. Well, we need more Russell Andersons here right now, but we need less Russell Andersons than we need people to go out and be like the Apostle Paul. That's not a downgrade, by the way. But we want a better position. Lastly, and we're done. You made a bad decision when you follow favorable circumstances. Now look at verse 13. So they've already made the decision. Paul says, don't do it. The centurion believes the guys. They don't like where they're at. They're looking for something better. Everybody's jumping on board to say, this is the way to go. We're all with you on this. And then look at verse 13. And when the south wind blew softly, supposing they had obtained their purpose, losing thence, they sailed to Crete. Then all of a sudden, the wind settles down for a little bit. And it's like, I knew we were right. I mean, after all, God's opening a door. It could be Satan's pushing you off a cliff. You know? We don't base our life based on circumstances, right? By the way, think of Jonah. God said, hey, Jonah, I want you to go to Nineveh. Jonah says, I feel an urge to go to Tarshish? I'm going to go to Tarshish. I think the Lord's leading me. And then just so happens, he goes down to the thing, and there's a ship there going to Tarshish. And it just so happens he had enough money to get a ticket, and it was leaving right away. I mean, God was in this. God was in it until he ended up in the fish's stomach. And he's thinking, you know what? I don't think God was in this after all. It seemed like everything was just perfect. This is what I'm supposed to do. Don't base what you do based off of what's going on around. It just seems like everything's opening up. Is God in it? Because God doesn't always work on the easy route. Sometimes God says, it works a little better if the road's bumpy at the beginning. But see, we want everything smooth. We follow circumstances. Yes, now listen to this. Yes, you don't have to listen to anything else I'll say, but listen to this. Yes, sometimes God confirms a right. Now get this. I don't even know where I got this. It just came out of my mind. The coffee was good. Yes, sometimes God confirms a right decision by circumstances, but he doesn't direct our decisions by circumstances. There's a difference. You make the decision, God's leading you somewhere, and you start to follow, and then God will work it out, but he doesn't use the circumstances for you to make the decision. Does that make sense? That's the cart before the horse, or the horse before the, whatever. But we are looking like, the whole thing is this. We're constantly looking for anything that will put the stamp of approval on what we want to do. Not to beat a dead horse because the horse is dead. We don't want to follow spiritual insight. We don't want to follow what God wants. And so we use all these different things to give us, what do they call it, confirmation bias. Because I want everything, aha, aha, aha. Everything cementing that bad decision I made. There's another stamp of approval. What does God say? What does God want? And let me say this. You know in your heart so many times, you know in your heart you're making the wrong decision. We do it. But we've already decided. I'll tell you this and I'm done. I haven't told it in a while. But we went down to Florida for a year to help start a church. Brother Bichardo, that was a really bad idea. Really bad idea. But I was all in. Everything seemed to work. My friends were going. I liked the guy that was starting the church. I could finish college down there. Florida, although I didn't realize until I moved there, but Florida was a lot better place to live than Chicago. Can I get a witness? Man, God, I'm like, I saw the palm trees, and I'm like, God's leading. So my wife and I had been married for about a year. We had an apartment. We decided to go. I rented a truck. We put the little belongings that we were taking with us in the truck, and we're leaving. Somebody had told me, like, hey, have you talked to your pastor, Pastor Black, about it? That was Brother Esposito, Johnny. I'll throw him under the bus. And he's like, yeah, I think Brother Black's for it. He'd be for it. I'm like, great. So I'm like, that's that last little stamp of confirmation on my decision. So I called Brother Black. You have to understand, the truck's already loaded. My apartment is already rented to somebody else. Like, hey, Brother Black, how you doing? He goes, hey, how you doing, Steve? How's it? Great. How's marriage? Right now it's great. Everything's good. I'm kidding. And I'm like, I was like, what do you want? I said, Pat, I'm going to go down and help start a church in Florida. I was thinking of going down and help start a church in Florida. And here's what we're doing. And I'll finish school down there. It'll be a great experience, you know. And, you know, we plan another church some other day, and I already know what's going on. And I gave him all of my reasons why it was a really good idea. And then he said, okay, Steve, let me get this straight. He goes, so you're going to do this? I'm like, yeah. He goes, and you're going to go to school down here, and you're going to do this? I'm like, uh-huh. And this guy's going to be the pastor, uh-huh. And you're going down. He goes, that's what you're thinking of doing? Uh-huh, uh-huh. He goes, hey, Steve, bad idea. And I'm looking at my truck. It's loaded, ready to go. I got nowhere to live. I'm like, excuse me, yeah, Steve, that's a bad idea. I'm like, well, thank you, Pastor Black, for your advice. I really appreciate it. You've been a blessing in my life. And I really appreciate your investment in my life. All right, Steve, have a good day. All righty. And we got in the truck and we moved down to Florida. That 1 year in Florida was the longest decade of my life. You ask my wife. Time is flying. If I ever feel like I want time to slow down, I'm going back to Florida. It was awful. It was awful. I kid you not. We had two cars. We loaded up all our stuff. We're moving to California, and we were driving out. And when I crossed the Florida border, the muffler of my car fell off. But I pulled over, one last parting gift from Florida. I pulled over, and I said, Lord, I'm never going back to Florida again, ever. Don't you want to go to Disney World? No. You want to go to Miami? No. How about the Florida Keys? Got my own keys. Don't need them. But you know what the point is? I did what some people do. I've already decided what I wanted. I followed all of the wrong things, and when I went back to the spiritual insight thing, it was too late. Listen, let's not make decisions so hastily. The decisions you make determine the path you take, which determines where you end up. And a few bad decisions. The question is, are you heading into a storm? If you're making bad decisions, I can stand up here 100% accurate and say, you're headed into a storm. It may not be a year or two, it's coming. And we don't want to do that. Let's all stand together this evening.